electricity on axioms. By Dr. P. Ramlu, Head Department of Mathematics, MVS Government Old Science Science College, Autonomous Mahabubnagar. So I want to going to explain some properties of algebra as well as axioms. Okay. What is aggregate? Aggregate, a non-empty set is called an aggregate. Any non-empty set is called an aggregate. Example, n, w, z, q, all. So natural number set, all number set, integers, rational numbers, real number. S is equal to 0, s is equal to 1, and q star is equal to q minus singleton 0, r star equal to r minus singleton 0, s is all. These are all aggregate. So empty set is not an aggregate. Groupoid. Let S be an aggregate and star be binary operation on S if S satisfies closure property with respect to star, then we say that S comma star is a groupoid. Let S be an aggregate and star be binary operation. Or I can write here S be a non-empty set. Let S be a non-empty set also, you may write, and star be any of binary operation on S. If it satisfies closure property with respect to star, then the structure S comma star is groupoid. So examples, n comma plus. Why? Because n is satisfies closure property with respect to partition. Similarly, w comma plus, q comma plus, z comma plus, r comma plus. Already we have discussed in lecture 2, these sets all satisfies closure properties with respect to addition, therefore these are all groupoids. Yeah, I'm writing here n comma dot, w comma dot, q comma dot, z comma dot, r comma dot, etc. These are all groupoids. Okay, because this set also satisfies closure property with respect to addition. If I take these sets n comma minus 1, n comma minus and w comma minus, so here n comma divide and w comma divide, z comma divide, or not groupoids. Why? Because these sets are not satisfies, right, n comma and w comma minus, so and okay, these n w not satisfies closure property with respect to minus, and n comma w comma z are also not satisfies closure property with respect to divide. Therefore, these are all not groupoid. Semigroup. So for every properties, we say that let us be an aggregate. See, in my topics, I will define like this only. Let S be an aggregate and star be binary operation on S if S satisfies closure and associative property with respect to star, then we say that S comma star is a semi group. If these are all sets, right? If any set which satisfies with respect to some operation two properties, closure and associative, then we say that S comma star is groupoid. So semi group, S comma star is semi group. Example, n complex. Why? Because n satisfies closure and associative with respect to addition. Therefore, we say that n complex is semigroup. W comma plus. W comma plus is also satisfies closure and associative properties with respect to place. This also semicolon. So similarly, Q, Z are also satisfies associative property and closure property with respect to place. Therefore, these are also semicolon. Similarly, with this dot. Already we discussed n comma dot and w comma dot and q comma dot, z comma dot, r comma dot are also satisfies. These sets are satisfies identity property, closure property as well as associative property with respect to this operation. Therefore, these are all semigroup. N comma minus w comma minus n comma divide w comma divide. And also minus also j. Also we are here writing here other things, right? R comma divide, R comma divide here. These are all not satisfied so closure as well as associative property. Therefore, these are all not semi group. Other thing is monoid. Let S be an aggregate and store P binary operation on S if S satisfies closure, associative, identity property with respect to store, then we say that S comma store be monoid. If a set which is satisfies closure, associative, identity property, three properties with respect to star, then you say that S comma star is monoid. Example. So already we know that W comma place. W comma place satisfies W. Okay. W is satisfies closure, associative, identity properties with respect to addition. Therefore, this W comma place is a monoid. What about n comma place? N comma place satisfies m is satisfies closure, associative property, but not satisfies identity property. Therefore, this is not monoid because it does not have identity element with respect to addition. That's why this n comma place is not monoid. Whereas you can take here z comma place. Z comma place is a satisfies z satisfies all properties, right? Closure, associative, identity. Therefore, it is a group. Similarly, if it satisfies this, this also or Q comma place, R comma place, these are also monoids with respect to addition. We may write C comma place also. I'm dealing with valences. I'm not mentioning here. Just I'm discussing only real number properties up to real numbers only. N comma dot. W comma dot, Z comma dot, Q comma dot, R comma dot. This set so satisfies three properties with respect to dot. Therefore, these are all monoids. Yeah, you can take here n comma place, n comma minus, W comma minus, n comma divide, W comma divide, Z comma divide, R comma divide, Q comma divide, or divide, not appearing perfectly here. Here divide. You may write R minus also, R comma minus, Q comma minus, and divide also. Both could work. These are okay. No examples of monoids. Groups. Let S be an aggregate and store be a binary operation on S. If S satisfies closure, associative, identity, inverse properties with respect to store, then we say that S comma star be a group. Be careful here. Let S be an aggregate and store be a binary operation on S. If S satisfies closure, associative, identities, inverse property with respect to store, then we say that S comma star, S comma star be a group. That means we have to take a test which satisfies four properties. Already these properties we discussed last class. So which can satisfy so Z complex? If you observe lecture 1 table, so it is easy to understand which of satisfies all properties. But take that Z complex satisfies closure property with respect to all pole properties with respect to addition. So therefore Z complex is a group. Similarly, Q complex and R complex. R complex here note W. R complex S is equal to singleton 0 and singleton 0 comma dot, or you can take that plus minus dot, whatever will be. We can say that these sets are satisfies all four properties. That's why these are all groups. Similarly, we can say that Q star comma dot R star comma dot dot here not just dot singleton zero dot one comma divide etc. These are all groups. If I take n comma dot w comma dot R comma dot Q comma dot are not groups. Why? Because this set not satisfies same. It is all same. Will not satisfy ideal property as well as inner property. If I take this satisfies three properties, not four properties. If I take this, W satisfies with respect to addition only three properties, not other property. If I take W, W comma dot W satisfies three properties, it not satisfies other than fourth property. So R comma dot is satisfies all properties, inner property is not satisfies. So that's why these are not abelian group. Let S be an aggregate and store be a binary operation on S. If S satisfies closure, associative, identity properties and inverse property as well as abelian property with respect to R, then we say that S comma store is an abelian group. So five properties, right? If it satisfies five properties, what is five properties? So closure, what are five properties? Closure, associative, identity, inverse and abelian properties with respect to R, then we say that S comma R is abelian group. Example. Okay. Just now written already groups, the whole groups are abelian groups, similarly by its respect addition test. If I take this, Z complex, Q complex, R complex, singleton 0 complex, singleton 0 comma dot, and minus, Q star comma dot, R star comma dot, singleton, these are all examples of abelian groups. These are non-examples of abelian groups. We will discuss later. Why? Because in algebra, in fourth semester, we have to discuss more examples for the groups either. Here I required only abelian group for defining some axioms. That's why we have discussed. Okay? So be careful. We have to go to the table and verify. Okay. N, if you take that, N satisfies only two properties with this addition. Z satisfies all properties, Q satisfies all properties with addition. So that's why there are groups and abelian groups also. If I take matrix set, the matrix set is not satisfied abelian property. It is a group, but with respect to multiplication, matrix sets are not satisfied. Why? That means GLN or can take the SLN R. That groups, but that not all abelian groups if you take that. We can take that DHL groups. DHL groups also not mentioned here. DHL groups are groups but not abelian groups. If you take any groups with respect to composition and with respect to matrix multiplication, that groups cannot have abelian property That's why those matrix, maybe they are any group with electric composition are non-abelian groups. You have to remember. So why? Because abelian group, why is important? So in real analysis, it may require, it has required some information. Okay, by using this properties, we have explained some axioms. So be careful. Up to now, we have discussed about the algebra part, but even though if I define algebra part, I required some these operations and these properties by defining some set. That's why I am explained these topics. So next, main topic is axioms. So here I am going to axioms. So axioms are three types. One is field axiom, two is ordered axiom, three is completeness axiom. Axioms of three types. One is field axiom, two ordered axiom, three is completeness axioms. Field axiom. Let S be an aggregate if S satisfies closure, associative, identity, inverse abelian properties with respect to addition. And S satisfies closure, associative, identity, abelian, and every non-zero element has inverse with respect to multiplication. Then we say that S satisfies field axiom properties. So that is simple. I'm taking that S be an aggregate. I do S comma plus abelian group. S star comma dot is an abelian group. Then we say that S comma plus comma dot is a field. Okay, so if it is any set which is satisfies these properties, just now already I explained, let S be an aggregate. If S satisfies all pi properties with respect to addition, and S star satisfies all pi properties with respect to dot, then only we say that a set is satisfies field axiom properties, and we write here S comma plus comma dot is field. Just now it is S comma plus or S comma dot are groups. Okay, S comma star S be an aggregate here. Discuss this now. Here again we had other notation S comma plus comma dot. That means the first with respect to this first operation, S is satisfies abelian group. With respect to S comma star is satisfies abelian group. So if it is satisfied like this, then we say that S comma S is satisfies field axiom properties. If I take Q and O, already we discussed all complex is an abelian group. Here R star the but or minus singleton zero is an abelian group. That's why. So that means O satisfies closure, associative, identity, inverse, and abelian properties with respect to addition. And also satisfies closure, associative, identity, inverse, and abelian properties with respect to dot. Therefore, R is a field. Which under means R complex comma dot is field. Similarly, Q also satisfies these properties. Therefore, Q complex is abelian group. And Q star comma dot is also abelian group. Therefore, Q plus comma dot, R complex comma dot, or field, and the sets Q and R are satisfies field axiom properties. So that means we say that R is field and Q is also field. Note, Z is not satisfies field axiom property. Why? Because Z comma dot is even not a group. We know that Z complex is a group, but Z comma dot is not a group. Why? Because with respect to dot, the set Z does not have inverse element. With respect to dot, Z does not satisfy inverse property. That's why Z is not satisfies field axiom property. Similarly, we say that W and also not satisfies field axiom properties. That means Z complex comma dot is not a field. R complex comma dot field and Q complex comma dot field when but did comma dot is not a field. So first axiom is over. Second axiom, ordered axiom. Any real number set satisfies the following properties by using greater than is known as ordered axiom. Okay, if it is you may have the greater than, we may depend using less than also. Okay, so it is very useful for analyzing the real numbers. Okay, so what we say, you can observe this. So here, if I take like this, if I take any two numbers in real numbers, what can we say that? So either A greater than B or B greater than A or A equal to B. This is very what we say that it is easy, but it is crucial part, because we are unable to judge the numbers. We may base it on doubts. Okay, so that's why A greater than B or B greater than A and A. If I take n two numbers, we may say it like this only. Okay, there is no other possible. So first property is that only. Yeah. If A comma B belongs to R, if I take n two numbers, then either A greater than B or A equal to B or B greater than A. This is ordered axiom one. Or axiom two. If A comma B plus R and A greater than B and B greater than C, then A greater than C. So A greater than C and B greater than C. What happen? A is greater than B and B greater than C. Then it is implies that A is greater than C. Ordered axiom three. If A comma B belong, A comma B comma C belong to R, you are taking differently. A is greater than D, then A plus C. Yeah, A plus C is also greater than B plus C. So if I take A to real numbers, A is greater than B, then A plus C is greater than B plus C. Or rather for, it is very important. If A comma B belongs to R and A C greater than 0 and A greater than D, then A C greater than B C. Whatever is C plus R, so similarly, or axiom 3 says that A, B, C plus R. Here I am taking that A comma B comma C plus R and C is greater than 0. I am taking like this. If it is like A comma B comma C plus R, then what happened? So if it is A comma B comma C plus R, I do A is greater than B, so then A, C greater than B may not be. Why? Because if I take 2 is greater than 1, but C is, if I take negative minus 1, then what happened? Minus 2 and minus 1, but minus 2 is less than minus 1. That's why I am putting here C is greater than 0. If you see negative numbers, it cannot be satisfied. Therefore, if A comma B belongs to R, C is greater than 0 and A is greater than B, then AC is greater than BC. Note, the ordered axiom can also be defined by using less than as follow. Just now we have defined using less than. In place of less than, we will say to greater than. So here you have put in greater than. In place of greater than, we may use less than and also define same statement. So okay, so what is the one with respect to our less than? Not have A comes to R, A is greater than, then A is less than B or A equal to B or B is less than A. Same here we have greater than, here we have. We have only less than symbol. If A comma belongs to R and A is less than, then and B is less than C, then A is less than C. If A B C belongs to R and A is less than B, then A plus C is less than B plus C. If A comma B belongs to R and C belongs to less than C, is less than 0. And for A B A is greater than B. Here. Here we have taking only C greater than 0 only, because
it fetic cannot be happen. Here I'm taking only c is greater than 0 and a is less than b, then ac is less than bc. But because fetic c is negative, then what happen? Say 1 is less than 2, if minus 1 is greater than minus 1, this not happen. Here something is there. Why I'm making here c is greater than 0 only. For I'm applying only for the less than symbol here only, not here. So here my c is real number, so therefore c is positive number, cannot be changed. So these are the ordered axiom properties. So all satisfy these properties, therefore R is ordered field. All these satisfies ordered axiom, and Q also satisfies these all properties. So Q is also ordered. Q satisfies ordered axiom properties. This is very useful set.
Inductive sets. Inductive sets. Inductive set. A non-empty set A is said to be an inductive set if first one, 1 belongs to A, second one, B belongs to A, then 1 plus B belongs to A. If any non-empty set is said to be inductive set if it satisfies this property. But A 1 belongs to A and B belongs to A, which implies 1 plus B belongs to A. Okay, if so, that means for any set is said to be inductive set, it can must containing saying a one number. 1 belonging to this number. If I take other number other than 1, that number also belongs to S, then only see that N is an inductive set. Okay. So a set A is an inductive set. For example, I am taking that n. So 1 belongs to n. In place of p, you can take that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to infinite number we have in the set. You may take that in place of n, you may take in place of p, you can take that any number out of the right. My choice here is 1 belongs to n. And taking here p equal to 3. Oh, this is 3 also belongs to n, right? In place of 3, can remember any number 2020. 2019, 2013, or you can take that 1729, Ramanujan number. You may take any number 3025, 3245, 3490, any number like this. You can take that if I add to this number 1, then what happens? Immediately we will get something. If I take p equal to 3, 1 plus p equal to 1 plus 3 equal to 4, 4 also belongs to n. In place of 3, you can take that any number 2020, what you will get 21, therefore that number also belongs to n. Therefore, n is an inductive set. If I take W, yeah, 1 belongs to W, why? Because first we have to condition, we have to verify that whether this set contains 1 or not. Other than, it's not possible. If it is contained 1 only, then we have to verify other conditions. So, that is why I am taking here, 1 belongs to W and comma P belong, P equals 100 I am taking here. 1 plus P equal to how much here? 1 plus P equal to 1 plus 100, that equal to 101, that means 101 belongs to W. Therefore, W is an inductive set. Similarly, you may observe that Z, Q and R also inductive set. Simply, you can observe that 1 belongs to Z and 1 plus B belongs to Z, Q belongs to 1, 1 belongs to Q and R belongs to R. If it satisfies this set, so this set also satisfies inductive properties. If I take that, non example, I am taking here, S is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1 belongs to S. P belongs to A 5, 1 plus P is equal to what happened 6. If I take 2, then what happened 1 plus 2 equal to 3, it is there. 1 plus, if I take P equal to 3, 1 plus 3 equal to 4, what is there? If I take 4, 1 plus 4 equal to 5. If I take 1 plus 5, so that means P must be any element in this set. If I take P equal to 5, then what happened 1 plus P is equal to 5, that is 6, does not belong to S. Therefore, S is not an inductive set. S is not an inductive set. If I take S is equal to single zero, is not inductive set. Why? Because a certain set is a inductive set, it must contain one element, first of all, one belonging to that set. But here I am taking a single time zero, therefore one does not belong to S. So this S is not inductive set. Why? Because if I take one belongs to, it has one belongs to S, but if I take one, other one, p equal to 1, there one, p equal to 1, there 1 plus 1 equal to, 1 plus equal to 1 plus 1, that equal to 2. 2 does not belong to this set. Therefore, S is not an inductive set. If I take Z minus, So z minus divided z minus equal what happened here? Z minus is equal to minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. That means set of all negative numbers which is containing z minus. So if I take 1, 1 is belongs to z minus? No. So 1 does not belong to z minus here. 1 does not belong to z minus. Therefore, z minus is not an inductive set. Z minus is not an inductive set. R minus. O minus, how to read out here? R minus nothing but this is a real number. We are here, we have 0. Here we have 0. From R minus nothing but these are negative numbers. These are all positive numbers. This set contains only negative number. That means x belongs to R. All this number belongs to R. But x is negative, negative number. That means x belongs to R such that x is less than 0. Is not an inductive set. Why? Because this set contains only negative numbers, not positive numbers. 1 is here. 1 does not belong to R minus. Therefore, this R minus is not an inductive set. If I take over plus, x belongs to R such that x is greater than 0. Is an inductive set. Why? Because x is greater than means set of all positive numbers. Here we have here. So that means it one contain the one here maybe here or here if here. One belongs to this set. If I add one here number, one plus some number is equal to that belongs to the set R plus. Therefore R plus is an inductive set. R is inductive and R minus is not inductive. R is inductive and R plus also inductive. Example. Other example is that x belongs to that x less than or equal to 1. 1 because x less than 1 is x less than 0. Here x less than or equal to 1. Then what happen? You can observe here. X is equal to, if I take 1 belongs to this set, right? X less than or equal to 1. 1 belongs to S. If I take minus 1, then what happen? P is equal to minus 1. Take that. P plus minus 1 equal to 0. 0 does not belong to this set or not? No, it is belonging to. If I take other set, is there any other element which is not possible? If I take in between these numbers, if I take p is equal to 1, one plus 1, p is equal to half. If I take p is equal to half, then what happen? 1 plus half, that equal to 3, 1.5. 1.5 does not belong into this set, right? So it may be after 1. 1.5 after 1. 1.5 does not belong into this set. Therefore, this set is also not an inductive set. Therefore, intersection of inductive set is natural number set. If I take set of all inductive, what are the inductive set? What now we have found? N, W, Z, Q, R plus. I can take that some other element also. If I do intersection, then what happen? So N is subset of W and W is subset of Z is subset of Q, Q is subset of R subset of R. That R plus R subset of R. So N is subset of R plus also. If I do all intersection, intersection W intersection Z, then what happen here? So the whole intersection will equal to, we will get N only. But because this is smaller set, which is subset of all other sets. So that's why I'm writing here set of all, intersection of set of all, natural number set is natural. Not. The smallest inductive set is natural number set. The smallest inductive set is natural number set. Well ordering principle. Every non-empty subset of N have least element. Every non-empty subset of N has least element. This is called well-ordering principle. Every non-empty subset of N have least element. Example. N is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What are the non-empty subset of N? So, minus 5 is equal to, if I take empty set, it is not empty. If I take other element, so, s is equal to 1. So,
1 is the least element. S is equal to 2, 3, 4, that means 2 is the least element. S is equal to 50, 51, 52, that means 50 is the least element. If I take any subset of n, which must have least number. So that's why. So this is called well-ordering principle.
Absolute value of real number.
So this is very important, why? Because so many people, we don't know about the this number. So how we define like this absolute value of a real number? Okay, I want to ask question. What is mod 1?
That is called 1.
Mod minus 1, that is the 1. Why?
First, as a student, they are all unable to sit in my class. Okay, so that because if I put any number in modulus, we will get to the answer is so many people are saying that if I put any number in mod, we will get only partial number. So why? Modulus, I don't know about that. They will say, but the actual definition is absolute value of a real number is the absolute value of a real number is x. It is denoted by mod x and it defined by the absolute value of real number x is denoted by mod x and defined by like this mod x equal to x if x greater than or equal to 0 minus x if x less than 0. So that's why by using this only we will get according to definition of modulus we will get if I put any number in this set we will get positive number only. Suppose why? Because I am taking that x is equal to 0 mod x mod 1 mod 1 equal to 3.
If x is greater than 0 then what we know here x only, right? So that means mod x is equal to x, that means mod 1 equal to 1. If x is equal to minus 1 which is negative, if x is negative then what we have x is equal to mod x equal to minus mod minus 1 equal to minus mod x minus x. X nothing but minus 1, minus and minus equal to plus. So that means according to this definition only we will get, if I put any number, we will get so this number. So we may study about the absolute value of real number, so other number also. So why? Because it is useful. Okay, absolute value properties we will use in future classes. You have to recognize and you have to remember what happened. If it is not clear, right? So many people don't know about this thing by definition. So you may clarify this. You may clear your doubt now. Okay. So in place of x, so we will put to by using this definition, then only we will get all positive numbers only. Yeah. Triangle inequality. So this is very crucial. Why? Because so many times we will use our topics in real analysis. If x comma y belongs to R, then mod x is less than or equal to mod x plus mod y for all x comma. If x comma belongs to y comma R comma x comma y belongs to R, then mod x plus y is less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. 2 comma 3 belongs to R. If I take this thing. 2 plus 3 equal to 5, mod 2 equal to 2, mod 3 equal to 3. This is equal case, both are same. So that's why these are equal. If I take like this, 2 minus 3 equal to 2 minus 3 equal to how much? Mod minus 1, that equal to 1. Mod 2 equal to and mod 3, mod minus 3 equal to 3. Mod 2 minus 3 equal to what happened? Minus 1, this is 5. So minus 1 is less than 5. So that is, this is the triangle inequality. If x comma y belongs to R, then mod x is less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. So that's why this is we will use, right? Need not to forget. Okay, you have to remember this thing. Integral part of the number, other beautiful example or beautiful definition. So the integral part of a real number x is denoted by box x and defined by box x equal to n if n less than or equal to x less than n plus 1 for n belonging to z. Here box x, this notation symbol, right, is read as box x. This expression is read as box x. It cannot be bracket x or square bracket x. We may read box x. Box x is equal to n if n less than or equal to x less than n plus 1 for all n belonging to z and x is belonging to real number. For example, I want to explain by this example, right? Box x is equal to what happened? If I, yeah, this is the condition is very crucial. N less than or equal to x less than n plus 1. If it is in this case, if x lies between n and n plus 1, we will get n only. So that's why I am taking n is equal to n belongs to z. That's why I am taking that minus 2 less than or equal to x less than minus 1. Minus 1 less than or equal to x less than 0. 0 less than or equal to x less than 1, 1 less than or equal to x less than 2, and 2 less than or equal to x less than 2, 2 less than or equal to x less than 3, 3 less than or equal to x less than 3. According to definition, what we know here, box is equal to n if n less than or equal to x less than n plus 1. That's why I'm writing here minus 2 less than or equal to x, right? Here minus 2 less than or equal to x, that's why I'm writing here box minus 2 is equal to minus 2. Box of minus any number, if I take any number between this and this, if I take box x in this between this, we will get minus 1 only. If I take any number between 0 and 1, we will get 0 only. If you get any number between 1 and 2, we will get 1 only. If you get 2 and any number between 2 and 3, we will get 2 only. If you get any number 3, between 3 and 4, we will get only 3. So, this is box x. We have written here according to box x definition only. Okay, if you use this here, box 3. 3 equal to what happened? 3. By using the definition, 3 less than equal to box is equal to n if n less than or equal to x less than or equal to n plus 1. Here box 3 is equal to what happened here? 3 less than or equal to x less than or equal to 3 plus 1 equal to 4. That means if it is box 3 is equal to, you get 3 only. Box 3.2 is equal to, even though if you get between any number 3 and 4, right? If 3 and 4 between number 3.2 also between 3 and 4, that's why I am writing here. 3 point box 3.2 also 3. Similar 3.1 equal to 3. 3 4.8 also 4. 0.9. So 0.9 where it is? So 0.9 lies between here. 0 between 1 only. So that means if it is 0 lies between this and this, the box 0.9 equal to what we get here? 0 only, that 0. Box minus 0.9. Minus 0.9 where it is? So minus 0.9 lies here. In this case, so sorry, here. Minus 0.9 lies here, here. So then what happened? Box minus 0.9 equal to minus 1. So minus 1 to box of minus 0.2 that equal to minus 2, box of pi is equal to, box of minus pi equal to what happened? Pi that equal to 3.14. Box of minus pi equal to what happened? Minus 4. So you can observe here, box of minus 3.14. Minus 3.4, minus 4, where it is? Look. Here you can take that minus 3 less than or equal to x less than minus 2. Other thing is minus 4 less than or equal to x less than 3. So if you take this, we will get minus 3 point box of minus 3, but minus 3.14, that equal to minus 4 only. If negative number, we will get previous negative number. If positive number, we will get only nearest to positive number, right? Next side goes to behind. Okay. Minus e. Minus e nothing but minus 3. Minus e nothing but what happened? E nothing but 2 pi. Exponential number 2.732. So 2.732 nothing but minus 3. Here if I take 3.14, that equal to box of 3.54 equal to 3 only. Box of e. Box of 2.732. That equal to 2 only. Fractional part of real number. Fractional part of real number. Up to now, we have recognized the integral part of number. I want to recognize the partial part, okay? Fractional part. That means 3.4, if we get, we get 3.4 equal to 3 only. I want to get 3.1. How to define here? The fractional part of real numbers x is defined by x minus box x. The fractional part of real number x is defined by x minus box x. The fractional part of 4.5 is equal to what happened? X minus box x. The fractional part of real number is defined by x minus box x. So x minus box x is nothing but Okay, x minus box minus x nothing but x. I want to find the pressure point of 4.5. That equal to what happen? X 4.5, box is equal to 4. X minus box is nothing equal to 4.5 minus 4. That equal to 0.5. So box 0.5. And what we will get here? Box of for this equal to 4. Box pressure point nothing but x minus box that equal to 0.5. So these topics we have covered today's lecture. In real analysis, we will discuss other lecture later. What are the topics we have covered till now, right? We have discussed all groups and monoid, groupoid, semi groups and abelian groups, and also we have discussed two axioms and some definition. So these are looking axioms only. One other axiom we will discuss next class. Okay, why? Because it requires some doubt or information. It is required some definitions. We will discuss later other topics. In this axiom topic, we have covered two axioms. Out of three axioms, we have covered two axioms. Other axioms also we have let's explain later next class or other next class. So we have to remember all these topics in future for proving some theorems. Okay, it is useful for entrance type also. Okay. Thank you for watching this lecture by Dr. P. Ramlu. Okay, so thank you.